Let us continue our discussion of the history of the Jews of Ashkenaz by looking at a really important movement of the 17th century that had remarkable repercussions really for the next 200 years easily, and one might say even into the present day in certain areas. I'm specifically speaking about the neo-messianic movement of Sabbatai Tzvi, shown here in this background image, and also to some degree of a successor movement of Jacob Frank that has some significant differences, but in many ways hews to the same path that Sabbatai Tzvi delineated. Just while we're on this image, have a look at the, the shein upon him, the visage of Sabbatai Tzvi, and on the right you can see there are some strange sort of scratches. One of those words looks like the word Ezekiel, Yechezkel. Hard to make out the rest of them. I think what happens quite often in the Christian iconography of the Sabbatai Tzvi movement, I'm going to show you several examples of this, where his story was actually big news for the entirety of Europe, really, in the Eastern Mediterranean. And we have lots of examples of Christian publications talking about Sabbatai Tzvi because it was really quite a novel thing to suggest that the Jews had produced another Messiah and that he had gathered a large following. And so all of Europe really watched this with great interest. But let us try and understand first some of the intellectual, political, and technological background to this really important movement that reverberated throughout the 17th century. I think the most important thing for us to start with is the dramatic rise in Kabbalistic study that occurred in the city of Tzfat in northern Israel, Safed, northern Israel, in the 16th century, prior to the advent of Sabbatai Tzvi, to use perhaps the word advent inappropriately. Everything is connected. The great expulsion of Jews in 1492, the subsequent slow emigration of Portuguese Jews after the forced conversion of 1497, this had a dramatic impact on all aspects of Jewish life in Europe, certainly on a demographic level with the huge numbers of Jewish refugees fleeing the Iberian Peninsula and desperately seeking solace and refuge elsewhere in Europe and also in the New World. Ultimately, even where I'm sitting right now, New York City, with its great reserve of Jewish population, is directly related to the refugees from the Iberian Peninsula. It also represented a huge religious upheaval, a split in the earth theologically for many Jews who regarded Spain as such a major important center of the Jewish diaspora, and to see it turned upside down after having created so many phenomenal works of religious literature and other works that many Jews, were convinced that the Messiah was right at hand, right, in 1492. The convinced that, something this devastating could not happen unless we are living be'ikvesa de Mashiach, in the footsteps of the Messiah, meaning you can hear the footsteps of the Messiah approaching, that we're talking really about being on the cusp of a brand new era. One of the focal points of this energy was undoubtedly this northern city of Tzfat in Israel, which had recently been opened up to Jewish migration by the Ottomans, who controlled the land of Israel at the time. And they instituted some favorable tax policies that attracted Jewish merchants, particularly textile merchants. And it was a site of significant attraction to a lot of these refugees from the Iberian Peninsula, including the family of Rabbi Moshe Cordovero, one of the early Kabbalists who ultimately settled here in Tzfat. There was also kind of like a specifically spiritual attraction to Tzfat as well, because the graves of many of the righteous individuals of the distant Talmudic past had been identified in the environs of Tzfat, and so many Jews moved there to be close to those holy sites. It's a little bit like what we talked about in the very first lecture, or perhaps it was the second, the centrality of a cemetery as being kind of like a centrifugal center where Jews are drawn to it, not centrifugal, centripetal center for Jewish migration. That's certainly true of the holy graves of Tzfat. And of course, once a lot of these Kabbalists in particular moved to Tzfat, creating cemeteries like this famous one with their characteristic blue stone or blue painted stone, blue being a color associated with warding off the evil eye, not quite the shade of the background behind me, but you know, you sort of get the idea. These graves in turn also attracted tremendous pilgrims and so on. The men standing in front of the grave there of the famous Rabbi Isaac Luria, the Arizal, the holy lion, who was originally from Egypt but who had migrated to the area. Just below him, in front of him, is the grave of the Ramak, Rabbi Moshe Cordovero, who I mentioned earlier. Up on the top right, you see the marker for Rabbi Shlomo Alkabetz, the father-in-law and teacher of the Ramak, and also the composer, among other things, of the famous Lecha Dodi hymn that is read every Friday night in synagogue. And there are many, many other, you know, really important people buried here who are all associated with this remarkable explosion of activity that occurred in the 16th century in Tzfat. It ended fairly abruptly towards the end of that century. There were a series of earthquakes that do affect northern Israel from time to time. There was a cholera epidemic that laid waste to much of the population. And Tzfat, you know, while always retaining its reputation as a great spiritual center and as a Kabbalistic center, never quite got to the same levels that it did in the middle of the 16th century. Now, what was really going on there spiritually? There was many different activities. By the way, I forgot to mention the greatest figure was the elderly Rabbi Yosef Karo, who went to Tzfat towards the end of his life. Rabbi Yosef Karo, a tremendous Kabbalist himself, but principally known as the author of the great Shulchan Aruch, the Code of Jewish Law. As I mentioned to you when we were talking about religious history, he's kind of like a transitional figure between the Rishonim and the Acharonim, and he was also someone who fled the Iberian Peninsula to eventually seek his home in Tzfat. So, what's going on here? Well, one of the major energies of activity is the research of Jewish mysticism, the Kabbalah. And, you know, Rabbi Moshe Cordovero was especially famous because he was the first individual to produce what we could call sort of like a scientific systemization of Kabbalistic wisdom. Much of Kabbalistic doctrine is, you know, perforce very hidden, arcane, and buried in elusive language, you know, and it's associated with a heavy reliance on a deep oral tradition and so on. Really trying to follow some of the main Kabbalistic texts like the Zohar can be extremely difficult. Even if you are fluent in Aramaic, it can still be really hard to do. You've got to have a teacher there to walk you through it. One of the major contributions of the Ramak, Rabbi Moshe Cordovero, was he said, okay, let's explain all of this from A to Z, working from general to particular, and he produced a book which was published in his lifetime. We are now talking about a period where publishing is a reality for Jews, like actual printing. That will become very important, and we're going to return to it in just a minute. And this initial sort of like introduction to Kabbalah called Pardes Rimonim, the Orchard of Pomegranates, was incredibly popular, cemented his reputation even during his brief life, and he went on to create many other great works, including Tomer Devora. One of the things that he describes in the Pardes Rimonim is this chart that I've set up here, which is essentially a chart of what they call the Sfirot in Kabbalistic language, the spheres, which is sort of like a metaphor for how God communicates reality to the universe. To take just a moment to explain it, and then we're going, well, actually, I have to tell it, you can't understand it otherwise, can't understand the rest of this lecture otherwise. The basic question that Kabbalah deals with and the Ramak explains is that how do you have an infinite being communicate existence to a finite universe, right? How is it possible if God suffuses the entire world and has no limits that we live in a world that has limits? How does the infinite and finite, how do they breach that formal abyss? So the idea in Kabbalah is that God, first of all, shrunk himself, a process called tzimtzum, shrinking, limited his influence over the universe, creating kind of like a vacuum of godness in the universe. These are very difficult concepts. I'm not a rabbi, by the way. I'm just going to walk you through them as best I understand them. But God created kind of like a space within himself that was empty of himself, sort of like, you know, I remember when I studied chemistry or biology in high school, like an amoeba, I imagine like a hole opening in an amoeba. That's not a very good metaphor, but it's what I'm working with in my mind. And then he slowly reinserted godliness into that vacuum through a multi-stage process, which we'll call the Sfirot. One of the most important metaphors is the idea of like hot oil poured into clay vessels. You know, like you've ever seen those kind of like dessert fountains at big weddings or something where they have like the punch flowing out of a faucet and it goes into one container and then it overflows into the next containers and then it overflows into the last containers and you can take a container for yourself to drink if you like. So that's kind of like the idea of the hot oil pours into one of these containers called a keli, which is essentially a model for the Sfirot, and then it overflows into the next keli, into the next keli, and so on, until you get to our world at the bottom, which is the repository of all of these emanations. Another way to look at it is, you know, you can't look at the sun with the unaided eye. It's dangerous. It burns out your retinas. But what you can do is you can take a mirror and look at the reflected light of the sun. And even that's kind of strong. So you know what? You might set up a second mirror where you would look at the second mirror, which reflects the first mirror, which reflects the light of the sun. And if you add up 10 mirrors like that, that would be like a model of the Sfirot that all represent a slight diminution. Each time it goes through the mirror itself absorbs some of the radiant energy of the sun until finally in the 10th mirror, you can actually look at the sun's light unaided. Now, why I'm explaining this to you is I gave you kind of like the Ramak's depiction, but the Arizal's depiction, this was his student. The Arizal traveled to Tzfat from Egypt to study with the Ramak, and they only studied together for less than a year before the Ramak passed away. The Arizal, who also only lived a very short lifetime, managed a tremendous amount of teachings, which were then propagated by his great student, Rabbi Chaim Vital. And the Arizal had a rather different take on how the Ramak described the Sfirot. The Arizal writes that the oil, the hot oil, as it enters the Kalim, overpowered each of those Kalim because it was simply too hot, too intense, and each of those Kalim, those containers, shattered. So as it were in the Arizal's conception, the oil came into the first keli and then it exploded, and the mixture of oil and the destroyed keli fell into the next one and then it shattered as well. And this happened all the way down until finally you get to the 10th keli, and the heat of the oil is sufficiently reduced and it's also mixed with the actual material of the broken vessels that it's able to exist in this world. So that's the doctrine known as Shvirat HaKelim, the destruction of the vessels. And in the Lurianic vision of Kabbalah, the task of the Jew is to try to repair this fundamental destruction by separating out the gross material elements that are present in this universe and freeing the trapped sparks of holiness that represents like the hot oil, the radiance of God that are buried within the physical universe. One of the most important aspects of the Arizal's approach, which is going to directly connect us to Shabbatai Tzvi, don't worry, is that the Arizal injected a tremendous note of urgency into the role of Jews in the world. That Jews are are tasked with this crucial activity of finding those sparks, elevating them from their material prisons, and as these sparks, as it were, fly upward, we get closer to the moment where the Messiah can be truly revealed, and we enter into an entirely different period of history altogether. The Kalim and the model of the Sfirot, as the Ramak presented it, was much more kind of like a description of the theological view of creation, but the Arizals added a verb to it, say an imperative, get out there and start doing this. The Arizals Kabbalah proved to be far more popular, had a remarkable degree of influence, for example, on the Hasidic movement that we will discuss, God willing, tomorrow, and gave it that impetus of, you know, you can't just sit around studying things. You've got to get out there and be active in the world because that is the task of the Jew. Now, this body of ideas, which were, circulated initially in the late 1500s, really the second half of the 1500s, with the advent of publication, began to make their way throughout the entire Mediterranean basin and into Europe as a whole. And it is in this context of the increasing popularity of the thought of the Arizal, particularly through the work of scholars like the Shalah, the great Rabbi Levi Horowitz, and his very important publication, Shnei Luchot Abrit, the two tablets of the law that gained great currency. Jews were like energized by this, and the Sabbatean movement was one of the kind of bizarre offshoots that was directly intellectually related to this new note of urgency sounded by the Arizal. So what's the basic story? So Shabbatai Tzvi, shown here in a rather interesting German depiction on horseback, he was an individual of great potential as a young man. He was very highly regarded. He was suggested for many different marriage prospects with important people, important young women. And he showed great talent, not only as someone who could lead prayers, he apparently had a very beautiful voice, very charismatic, good-looking, tall, those kinds of attributes, and also quite learned, quite adept in the Kabbalistic study. He ultimately got involved in these group of ideas that in the end suggested to him that he was in fact the Messiah. Now, for a long time, Jewish historiography viewed his delusion of grandeur as a type of criminal activity, that he had intentionally, wickedly deluded the large number of followers that he garnered throughout Europe. More modern scholarship, in particular since the work of Gershom Scholem, has been widely circulated. He was one of the principal biographers of Shabbatai Tzvi within the movement of Kabbalah as a whole. There's been the growth of a more sympathetic view to Shabbatai Tzvi, understanding him as someone who was subject to some kind of mental illness, perhaps something like bipolar disorder, because he would have like these manic phases, which we called illuminations, and then he would have these depressive phases as well. Obviously, I'm not a psychiatrist. I can't speak to these things, but he definitely was somewhat eccentric, to put it mildly. So let's look at the political context and the technological context, and we're going to look at his life and activity in particular. The political context should be broadly familiar with us now that we just spent an hour in the last lecture looking at the Khmelnytsky rebellion. This is a period of tremendous political upheaval. According to Dr. Stampfer, possibly 50% of the Jewish population of Ukraine was destroyed by the Cossacks in that period. The overall number, he estimates, is much smaller than earlier, rather inflated estimates, maybe 18,000 or 20,000 people. A huge tragedy, but nowhere near the scale of what some other historians have opined without sufficient research. But nevertheless, losing half of the population is an incredible devastation. A large number of displaced populations were dispersed through Europe. Glickel of Hameln, the famous memoirist that we mentioned several weeks ago, what actually describes how her family, like many others in Germany, took in refugees from these upheavals in the middle of the 17th century. And Shabtai Tzvi's main activity really occurred in the two decades following this tremendous peasant upheaval in the 17th century that had such havoc wreaked on the Jewish world. But let us not forget the really important element of publication, which is something that the Jews, once they discovered it, they really loved it. Jews had been publishing from the very early period of print. In fact, there are some possibility that it was actually Jews in Provençal who even invented movable type, which was a key element in the technology necessary of efficient printing. But although that particular thread has not been completely developed, we do know that by the late 15th century, Jews were already publishing many titles, including the Talmud. And in the 16th century, in Venice in particular, publishing just exploded for Jews. Jews rushed to it and because it was great, right? It meant that all of a sudden, all of these works which had previously only existed in manuscript and could only be copied laboriously and expensively by professional scribes, and then they were very fragile, easy to lose, if they were seized by the church, as happened several times, they could easily be burnt and hard to replace. But with publication, with printing, all of a sudden the price drops out the bottom, that no longer are we talking about, like to use contemporary terms, a Torah scroll, I think, costs about $50,000 to produce because of all the man hours that go into actually writing the scroll out. Whereas you can go to a Judaica bookstore and you can buy the same information for $10, $15. I mean, it's just a tiny fraction of the overall cost. And Jews love the idea of being able to read so much more. So over the next few centuries, Jews become passionate purchasers of books. They really become the Am al-Kitab, the people of the book at that point. Previously, before that, they were the people of the scroll, I guess, the people of the manuscript. And works like this one here, the Shnei Luchot HaBrit, become extremely popular. And ideas circulate with accelerating rapidity throughout the 17th century and onward. This also has tremendous impact on the democratization of knowledge. Once information can be distributed at a much lower cost, it becomes accessible both in terms of an expanded range of classes of people, but also to women as well. Women who, were typically much more literate than non-Jews historically, but generally not as literate as their menfolk. They typically would be literate in the vernacular, like Yiddish, but less so in the language of the state, and less so in the religious languages of Hebrew or Aramaic. Only very exceptional women could make out more than, let's say, perhaps the prayer book. In fact, in Ashkenazi synagogues, it was very common to have one educated woman sitting in the women's section of synagogue and repeating the Torah reading, or if there was a sermon in Hebrew or something like that, repeating it to the less educated women who had no access to Hebrew whatsoever. So with printing, all of a sudden you begin to open up the possibility of, hey, we can afford to teach this stuff to our daughters as well. And that will play a great role in Shabbatai Tzvi's movement, which was actually very, very sensitive to both printing and to women, as we shall see. So what exactly happened with the movement? So the basic story is that you have this individual, Shabbatai Tzvi. He's born in Smyrna. Here's a quick map where you can see where he wanders around the Eastern Mediterranean. He begins in his late teens to experience these emotionally unstable moments, where, as I mentioned, he describes periods of great euphoria, followed later by some depressive episodes. And although he is very highly regarded as a youth, he begins a period of wandering. And while he is engaged in these wanderings, and he's also quite an educated young man, studying Kabbalah, very conversant with Kabbalistic ideas, he ultimately runs into an individual known as Nathan of Gaza. Nathan of Gaza recognizes the potential inherent in Shabbatai Tzvi, and he becomes not only his sidekick, but also his major propagandist, his publicist, who ultimately would reveal his friend as the Messiah, as the long-awaited Redeemer of the Jews. And amazingly, this idea gains tremendous popularity in Europe. Now, we can certainly opine as to the basis for this fact. You know, you can certainly point to the desperation that Jews felt after the 17th century Khmelnytsky uprising. You can point also to the influence of the Kabbalah of the Arizal. Certainly Jews have been at this now for 100 years since the Arizal, and maybe it's time already that since the Arizal's teachings have been revealed to the world, another century has passed and now it's actually coming to fruition. You can point to the rapid change in society that's happening all over Europe. Non-Jewish society in particular is going through many changes in the 17th century, and this all comes together, and Shabbatai Tzvi actually attains a significant following, sometimes among very well-respected figures in Cairo and in Jerusalem. And he eventually, props egged on further by Nathan of Gaza, he believes it all the more himself, proclaiming himself as Messiah, making all kinds of interesting proclamations about his life and so on. He goes through several phases as his, let's say, dementia grows and grows. He engages in ever more bizarre activities. For example, claiming that he can levitate, claiming that he has the power of kvitzot haderech, right? The shrinking of distances, his ability to transport himself or teleport himself from place to place. Here you can see a woodcut that's labeled Shabbatai Tzvi, the false Messiah, and attributes to him some of the many activities that he's engaged in. He also, you know, engages in a heavy antinomian campaign that we're going to have to explore right now. Here is one of the prayer books that were composed by his followers associated with his new teachings. What were essentially the teachings of Shabbatai Tzvi? Well, the first is obviously the notion of messianism, that he has come to actually represent the end of history and the beginning of a totally new era. That messianism is precipitated by an adherence to antinomianism, which literally means opposing lawfulness, right? Nomos meaning like law in Greek, and antinomos. And when it was kind of like moderate, his antinomianism was expressed in things like the nullification of fast days. You have, of course, the famous fast of the 9th of Av, which occurs usually in late summer, that you know, corresponds to the destruction of the temples in Jewish thought and the exile of the Jews. But in Jewish thought, that fast day will be transformed into a day of gladness and feasting in the era of the Messiah. And so Shabbatai Tzvi says, okay, that's it. Ninth of Av is now a feast day. So for his followers, this was great, although it was a very radical kind of thing for those who were less positively inclined to his teachings. Other antinomian activities were considerably stranger. Like, for example, his insistence on entry into a synagogue one Sabbath that he was denied access to. He used an axe to break down the door on the Sabbath, a clear transgression of the Sabbath. Once present in the synagogue, he essentially took over functions, would call up women to the bima for an aliyah, which was another aspect of his thought. He was extremely egalitarian. He really looked to women as a great source of his movement, and it's hard to gauge exactly how much that contributed to his overall popularity, but many of the things which he proposed were later actually adopted by more liberal movements in 19th and 20th century, in particular Judaism. He would, speaking of women, he was actually married several times. It's quite likely that the first two weddings were never consummated. That may have something to do with his mental illness in one way or another. He later, however, married an orphan woman who had some kind of a checkered past. There were some questions about, you know, her level of promiscuity prior to meeting Shabbatai Tzvi. This actually appealed to him because there is, of course, a couple of prophetic characters who marry women of similar repute in the Bible. She was actually an orphan from the Khmelnytsky rebellion itself, which distinctly appealed to Shabtai Tzvi. She proved to be his most devoted supporter, and we'll meet her in a moment. He also at one point actually married a Torah scroll. That is exactly what I mean by what I said. He actually performed or had performed a marriage ceremony between himself as the groom and an inanimate object, the Torah scroll, however holy, as the bride. But you get a sense of just how wild this went. Later on, there were credible rumors, although certainly, you know, inflated because of their salacious nature, of a widespread activity, especially among his followers, of what was called avera lishma, which means sinning for the right reasons. Very complex doctrine in Kabbalah. If you think back to some of the kind of bizarre stories in the Bible, like Tamar dressing herself as a prostitute in order to have relations with her father-in-law, in the book of Genesis, a chapter, I think it's 37, that's usually skipped over in kids' classes and things like that. And this idea that even for, or on a lesser level, Rebecca, deceiving her husband Isaac in order to make sure that Jacob gets the blessing rather than his brother Esau. So difficult discussion theologically, but his followers definitely picked up on this idea of avera lishma and used it principally to nullify many commandments in the Torah, including the consumption of non-kosher food, the violation of the Sabbath, and the violation of marital vows as well, which was perhaps one of the more popular elements of Sabbateanism. It was certainly one of the elements that gained wider circulation when people talked about Sabbateanism, saying, you know, do you know what they do? Things like that. So that was definitely part of the story surrounding him. He was open to change in a very big way, not only in terms of his own Sabbatean message, but as I mentioned, when he would like take over synagogues, he would demand that rather than reading from that Sefer Torah, which was, you know, okay for him to be married to, but not okay to be read from publicly, and he would demand that people use the newfangled printed Chumash, the printed Sefer Torah, rather than the old-style scroll. Now, as he's moving on his career, his mania increases. Those periods of euphoria become larger and larger and more longer lasting, and egged on by people like Nathan of Gaza and his increasingly enthusiastic followers, he decides that it's now time for him to reveal himself to the Ottoman Sultan, to demand that the land of Israel be turned over to him as the Jewish Messiah, and then he will initiate the Messianic Age. So this interesting sort of comic book version, like the issue of the broadsheet that we saw a while ago about the host desecration and Passover, sort of tells the story of Shabbatai Tzvi. We'll just zoom in on a couple of elements of it. So Shabbatai Tzvi goes with Nathan of Gaza, sails off to Constantinople to meet with the Ottoman Sultan and to say, okay, I'm here. Give me the city of Jerusalem and the land of Israel so that I can begin my messianic period, messianic age. I think that's Nathan of Gaza in the front there blowing the trumpet. Here comes the Messiah, that kind of thing. He meets with the representative of the Sultan. This picture here shows him actually meeting with the Sultan. That actually didn't take place. The Sultan didn't want to give him the time of day. He sent an emissary to him, but he lays out his case, and the Sultan says to him, "That's so nice to meet you, Mr. Messiah. Do you mind if I call you Shabsi? Is that okay? I have a counteroffer. I'm not prepared to give you the land of Israel. Sorry, I kind of like it, but I will allow you to remain alive if you agree to accept Islam. That is, you may, you know, leave my presence and authority unscathed as long as you become a Muslim." And to the great dismay of his followers, Shabtai Tzvi accepts the offer. And he converts to Islam, and his thousands of followers, there's a lot of debate over exactly how large his following was, but it was certainly very significant from all across Europe. They are crestfallen because he has abandoned Judaism. And the whole reason they were following is because they felt he was the culmination of Judaism. Here is him being taken away to by soldiers to be redressed in Ottoman turbans and so on. Here is his wife Sarah, who joins him in his Islamic conversion, his apostasy. I find Sarah especially interesting. And actually, there's a great book written by Ada Rappaport Albert that discusses women and Sabbateanism at much more length. But I note that she was early a trendsetter. Look at that hairstyle. Doesn't it look a lot like Queen Amidala of Star Wars? I definitely think so. There's certainly a connection there between Sarah, Mrs. Tzvi, as it were, and Queen Amidala. Okay, but sorry about that. So what ends up happening? The movement falls apart. The vast majority of his followers all kind of like limp back home. Many of them have already sold their belongings, their properties at a fraction of their value, and they have to start all over again. But there is a small minority of his followers who double down. And this is an interesting phenomenon where sometimes when people are, I read about it a little bit in the context of some bizarre American political beliefs, for example, that sometimes when people believe passionately in something and then they're shown clear evidence that it is not as they saw it, rather than acceding to logic and saying, wow, you know, I was wrong, I now have to sort of regroup, some people will actually redouble their efforts to believe, and they'll create a new kind of false mentality to affirm their earlier erroneous choice. In the case of some of the followers of Shabbatai Tzvi, they actually said to themselves, okay, wait a second, Shabbatai Tzvi is definitely the Messiah. We have already accepted that. That's non-negotiable. So maybe his conversion to Islam means that Jews must all convert to Islam in order to kind of like bring together these two Semitic faiths. Yeah, that's it. And so many of his followers elected to convert to Islam along with him, and they constituted a coherent community that lasted well into the 20th century called the Dunme. This is one of their mosques in Thessaloniki in Greece. They actually had a strong presence in Turkey and Syria and elsewhere. And there's a noted presence of them in 20th century Turkish politics, for example. Quite fascinating. There are also reverberations of neo-Sabbateanism throughout Europe. By the way, what I should mention, the end of Sabbatean's personal story is that after his initial conversion to Islam, he still had to deal with his mental issues, unfortunately, and they continued to plague him. It turns out that he went back and forth with even his conversion and with a lot of the things he had said, and he proved to be a bit of a thorn in the side of the Ottoman authorities, who found him a nuisance. Like, for example, he was constantly giving out post-messianic authorities. He was naming people, okay, you can be king of Africa, and you can be the vizier of Europe, and things like that. And it was creating a certain amount of disruption among his followers and among Jews in general. So ultimately, he was imprisoned. In prison, among the last things he did was he requested a Yom Kippur Machzor for his own purposes so that he could pray the great prayers of atonement and penance while he was in prison. So I think in many ways he can be regarded as a tragic figure, but I leave that to you if you want to read the work of Gershom Scholem and many others. But Neo-Sabbateanism persisted for centuries, not just with the Dunme who actually converted to Christianity. There were actual followers of Sabbatai Tzvi who were still embedded in Jewish communities, who practiced their understanding of Judaism secretly, typically, because they realized how they would be excoriated by the larger communities. And many prominent rabbis were falsely, sometimes perhaps not so falsely, accused of harboring Sabbatean beliefs. Perhaps one of the most notorious was the attack on Rabbi Yonasan Eibeschutz of Altona, who was one of the most highly regarded rabbis of Europe, and he fell under withering criticism from Rabbi Yaakov Emden, who accused Rabbi Eibeschutz of invoking Sabbatean teachings in his own Kabbalistic studies, in particular in the production of amulets, which was kind of like an industry that that Ashkenazi Jews engaged in, Sephardic Jews as well. It's really a universal thing, the production of small amulets that are prayers for health and healing and for sustenance, livelihood, marriage, all kinds of things like that, which is a long-standing tradition in Judaism, the Talmudic era and further before that. But Rabbi Yaakov Emden studied some of the amulets produced by Rabbi Yonasan Eibeschutz and said, he's definitely a Sabbatean. And so people lined up on either side who was their favorite rabbi that they would defend, and it was like a rather major controversy in the 18th century. Similarly, case of a great, well-known figure, the fantastic Ramchal, Rabbi Moshe Chaim Luzzatto, also an 18th century thinker. He's perhaps most well known as the author of Mesilat Yesharim, a phenomenal ethical treatise that continues to be studied today. I myself have gone through it many, many times. I think I've gone through it 27 times now, primarily because I heard once that the great Vilna Gaon studied it 101 times, and I'm hoping that if I go through it that many times, maybe I will, you know, turn out to have real worthwhile ethical behavior. At any rate, the Mesilat Yesharim was written by a man who is principally known perhaps for this ethical work, but he was at heart really a Kabbalist, and he wrote some tremendous Kabbalistic works, but he was accused of infusing his Kabbalah with the teachings of Sabbatai Tzvi. He was hounded out of his native land in northern Italy, and he sought refuge in Amsterdam. And on the way to Amsterdam with his family, he was actually put under house arrest in Frankfurt by critics who suggested that he was a late follower of Sabbatai Tzvi. This is like, you know, a good 80 years after Shabbatai Tzvi has already passed away, and the Mesilat Yesharim himself is held under house arrest. All of his writings were confiscated by the local Jewish court and then buried and lost. So a tremendous amount of his work we no longer have extant. It is moldering somewhere under a cellar floor in the city of Frankfurt am Main. And nevertheless, he was able to exonerate himself from all charges, as Rabbi Yonatan Eibeschutz was as well. He went on to Amsterdam, later to Israel, where he passed away near Akko. But at any rate, the reverberations of the Sabbatean debacle continued throughout Europe for a couple hundred years. And perhaps the last expression of this, or the last really meaningful organized expression of this, occurred in Poland under the leadership of someone who claimed personally to be the reincarnation of Shabbatai Tzvi, one Jacob Frank, shown here. And I don't think I want to overbalance this lecture by going into too much detail with Jacob Frank, but the ironic parallel with Shabbatai Tzvi is that while Frank also proclaimed himself the Messiah, unlike Shabbatai Tzvi, he did not appear to have the same level of possible mental illness. He seemed to be more of the charlatan type, I think, when a casual outside reading would reveal that. And ultimately, when he came under fire from the Jewish community that wished to place bans on him, ultimately they did put him in cherem. They did place a ban on him, which would mean that Jews would be forbidden to associate with him in any way, to do business with him, even to stand within 6 feet of him. He sought refuge in the home of a bishop in Poland. And one of the great criticisms leveled against him was that he was not following the dictates of the Talmud, something we discussed in a lecture a little while ago. This was something that the bishop warmed to and actually used the Frank situation as a foil to attack the Talmud as something which would otherwise be, he argued that it's a very noxious impact on the Jewish population of Poland, preventing them from converting to Christianity and so on. Jacob Frank obliged and actually converted to Catholicism. That's kind of like the interesting parallel to Shabbatai Tzvi, who converted to Islam. Jacob Frank converted to Catholicism, largely for opportunistic reasons in connection with this particular bishop who sheltered him, and in so doing resulted in the confiscation and destruction of some 10,000 Talmudic volumes, a huge loss to the Jewish intellectual heritage in Poland at that time. He later went on, now as a nominal Catholic, but still, you know, presenting his vision of himself as a Messiah, traveled throughout Europe. His daughter Eva, shown here, took off after him, following in much the same vein. Also, both of them involved with similar activities, credibly accused of engaging in antinomian behavior. The sexual aspect of their practices was definitely widely known, and you know, the subject of many salacious rumors. And ultimately, the entire movement ended in defeat. Eva Frank herself died penniless, but nevertheless, you see the same kind of readiness for the Messiah that characterized a certain number of the Jewish followers of both Shabbatai Tzvi and of Jacob Frank. That kind of like sums up this huge intellectual, spiritual whirlwind that had tremendous impact in the case of Shabbatai Tzvi over most of Europe, in the case of Jacob Frank, particularly in Eastern Europe. But that's where I think I'd like to leave it for today. Let me thank you all for listening to this brief overview. Have an excellent day.